Hey everybody, Alex Moen here, and I just wanted to do a quick video based on something kind of unique that happened last night, while it's still kind of fresh in my brain. So I got the pretty unique opportunity to be able to speak with Henry Samueli. He's actually a billionaire, and at least at this point in my life, I don't get to have one-on-ones with too many billionaires. And so I got to pick his brain a little bit and kind of wanted to put it into video form, what I took away from it. And what I'll do also, just in case I miss part of it on the video, if you're watching this on YouTube, I've got kind of like a blog write-up that's kind of prompting me here on some key points. So if I miss anything, you can read down below. But for a little bit of background, so I went to UC Irvine, an event there last night. They call it the Distinguished Speaker Series. And essentially, they just get really high-level people from all over to be able to talk. And Henry Samueli was the main speaker. So he's the founder of Broadcom. He's the owner of an NHL team, the Anaheim Ducks. And he's also a philanthropist who jumped on board with the Bill and Melinda Gates giving pledge. And he's already given more than $600 million to charitable causes. And he's still pretty young, too. At least, you might expect him to be, 70s or 80s or that kind of thing, but pretty spry, guy there. But anyways, afterwards, so after that speaking event, there was like a food and wine set up afterwards. And I almost didn't do it because I do have, MBA homework to do. It was after, a long day of work, that kind of a thing. And it didn't seem like I didn't see him out there initially at first. So, but I went, put my stuff in my car, decided to come on back and, if nothing else, get a little food and, a glass of wine, something like that. And then, so again, he wasn't there initially. So I was just kind of making small talk with my food and everything there. And then he did end up coming out a little bit later. So I'm not sure if he got stopped behind the scenes or what might have happened. But I guess for a little bit of more background on him and Broadcom, because if you're searching for it, it's got kind of a mixed and confusing background because it was recently purchased by a company that decided to use the Broadcom name and brand and all that as well. So Henry Samueli, he started Broadcom in 1991. He started on just a $5,000 investment. His first year in business, they only did $44,000. And then it seemed to grow pretty rapidly from there. So even just based on those relatively modest beginnings, he was able to pick up 11 employees in that next year right after. And then something like 5 years after that, they actually had an IPO, and it was a very successful IPO as well. So since this, for me, I didn't necessarily anticipate to get to talk to him or anything. So it's not like I had any, intelligent questions planned out or anything like that. What I was keeping my fingers crossed for was, he'd probably come out, he'd get swamped by people. And if I could just be like within earshot, maybe I'd get a golden nugget or two, or, just to be around, that kind of person and their way of thinking, there's value in that alone. So when he first came in, I was, again, eating and drinking, making small talk. So just on the off chance that I would get to shake his hand, I finished my food. So I gave it a few minutes there. So I just have my glass of wine and walk up to him, or at least to his group. And when I walked up to him, there was a group there. And it actually turned out to be a bunch of high schoolers and younger undergraduates, because I guess Henry's very involved with lots of youth support and things like that. So they were part of one of his programs, and they were just saying thank you, that kind of a thing. So, it wasn't necessarily the in-depth business or technical talk that I was hoping to overhear. But then, an adult chauffeur came up and said, okay, well, thank you, but, we've got to go. And then all of a sudden, all of them just left, and then it's just me and Henry there for one-on-one time. So that was awesome. Good timing there. So what I had been thinking, if I got as I was listening to the kids talk and, knowing that I'm probably not missing too much aside from the, the thank yous, that maybe I should think of a smart question or two to, pose to him if I get the opportunity, because he seems to be, talk at least a little bit to each person kind of in the group, at least that was closest to him. So what I found interesting, I mean, it's interesting that not only he started a business, in a semiconductor industry, nonetheless, on $5,000, but I mean, $44,000 in a first year, that's pretty modest. And how does he get 11 key individuals to help take Broadcom off on its explosive growth trajectory? Because those first, 11 key individuals and his co-founders, they'd be absolutely instrumental in setting that solid foundation. So I found it interesting because, to get high quality people, if you're showing them your financials or anything like that, probably can't afford salaries or, much of anything else there. So, you'd think that you'd almost get lower quality people and they'd have, some tough initial struggles and things like that. So what I found kind of interesting, I guess this dives more into his background, was so he has an engineering background, got his, degrees at UCLA, even got his PhD there, and actually went into being a professor. So he's a professor there for 10 years, actually. And I find that especially interesting too, because most people who go the academic route, they don't necessarily have business sense, or what they're working on can't necessarily, go over to business there. So the fact that he not only got that, and as he's talking about all of that, it's standing out even more. But what he was saying was, well, first his background and his credentials were absolutely key there, as was actually being a professor, because what he did was most of his co-founders, or he said all of them initially, so I didn't ask up until what point, but they were all either current or former students. So what's interesting there is, having a high-level PhD himself, being able to do a lot there. But then you can almost cherry pick. You can find the great students there, stay in touch with them, and they're of course going to be better employees there, right? Like you don't have, there's not the wild card as to what their actual capabilities are, because maybe somebody has a degree, but they're not actually great at, one thing, or maybe your personalities will clash, or maybe they don't have a good work ethic, or it could be a million different things there, right? So he didn't have any of those issues. And I found that extremely interesting there as well. So not only was he able to build a very solid core team that had all the expertise, he essentially used his academic background to vet out and get the more solid people there as well. So that was very interesting. Let's see, what did we jump to next? Well, I guess one big thing so I gave him a little bit of background about myself, currently being an MBA, wanting to, pick his brain and see his recommendations for, growing a company again, given my particular situation, and, how to best go about that. It's not something I've actually spoken too much about here or with anyone in general, but before getting my MBA, I do have the more long-term goal that would be best accomplished by having those, higher end credentials or PhD in more engineering or that sort of a thing. But that's much further down the line. I wanted to essentially run a business, use that business to achieve financial freedom, and then I don't have to worry about, student loans or anything like that. And so it was really, I almost went back just to get, an engineering degree to go with my other bachelor's degree so that I could start prepping there instead of going the MBA route. But I chose the MBA route thinking it could enhance my earnings and maybe my businesses, in the meantime to achieve that financial freedom more quickly. So it was kind of a toss-up there. But what he was saying was with the MBA, that's great for, having all the core knowledge and knowing how to build a business around something. But it doesn't have that core, different thing. Like if you want to do something new or different or technical, like you should have that yourself. And I asked, and I kind of went into, well, a little bit of programming backgrounds, but no credentials or anything in there. What do you think about partnering for that, and running that back by him? And he said, you could partner on that, right? You could get a highly technical partner, and, you know, I could be the business, sales, marketing, operations person. But it, from his perspective, it's essentially luck then, right? Is you don't know, if you don't have the technical knowledge, you can't find the flaws in their thinking. You're relying very heavily on them. So not only can you not correct them, you can't catch their BS. If you're partnering with someone there, I mean, what if you just don't get along? Like, who's the actual decision maker, you know, the business? He didn't say, you know, decision maker, but just the way he's talking about things made me kind of think, it's like, okay, well, the one person, if I want to do something drastically different, I need to have that high level expertise, and I need to be able to do everything myself. So not necessarily we're, you know, getting the employees or the partners to fill in the gaps, although that's incredibly important. To have something game changing, you need those high quality people, and you need to be able to do it yourself too. So that was pretty, I think, heavy there. That's actually something that's been in the back of my mind. You know, again, maybe 10, even 20 years down the line, I plan on working my entire life. So no rush there. But it's interesting that I kind of solidified, or at least brought a little bit of clarity to something that I had been thinking about there. So aside from that, the last takeaway, at least from the one-on-one aspect, that I think I'll get into, you know, a key takeaway or two from the speech as well. But from the one-on-one aspect, I was asking him, and I kind of knew the answer to this, like if you're starting a Broadcom, you know, again, you know, a new business, but it could be anything, would you still go in the same direction? Or would you start something new? And if you start something new, where do you think, you know, you would see, have the best odds of success there? And of course he said, you know, he wouldn't get into the semiconductor industry. And I kind of anticipated that, you know, it was 1991, that was an earlier industry. Right now it's slightly more commoditized. But I just wanted to be sure on that front. So then even after trying to prompt him, because, you know, some things that I've been thinking about is what, well, what's around the corner, you know, of course, quantum computing, artificial intelligence, some other things there. But he actually said he'd get into healthcare. So I found that interesting. And then I had to, you know, double check, like even with the bureaucracy and everything there, because I think that's the biggest thing to healthcare now. It can be great ideas, but the bureaucracy takes forever. He says, yeah, even with the bureaucracy, if you're starting again, you know, he thinks healthcare is essentially ripe for disruption. So that was kind of the lowdown of our conversation with the key takeaways. It was awesome. It was only probably about 5 minutes, maybe less, but I got a lot out of it. And I think it pretty, what I was hoping would at least be heavy hitting questions and things like that to pick his brain with. For the his presentation itself, there were a couple key takeaways there. So, I mean, lots of it was just the moderator asking, you know, Wikipedia questions about his background and upbringing and things like that. But I would say his biggest thing that I haven't touched on yet was about giving and philanthropy. So it's better to give now, even if it's just a little bit, even if you can't give money, give time. And even if you can only give $20, you know, 20 bucks is better than nothing. But, and that's something that, again, has kind of been in my mind as well. I mean, I'll volunteer every once in a while, unfortunately, maybe only a couple times per year, and give, you know, money here or there. But it's sporadic. It's based on who asks for it and seems to be a good cause. It's not necessarily something that I'm, you know, internally motivated about or anything like that. And so the way he said to go about it is to first think about what internally motivates you, like what, because there are nonprofits in all sorts of areas. What would kind of motivate you? What do you think can have a big impact on the world? And then think, well, okay, what ways could that change? Like, you know, let's say, again, let's say just healthcare, for instance. Well, how can a nonprofit healthcare, like what extra value can be brought there to take it to the next level? But again, this can be for any industry. And then once you think about that and you have a few ideas, then try and find the nonprofits that are actually working and doing those specific things within the industry and the ways that would motivate you there. And then focus on them. So whether they're big or small, get involved with them. And I think that's really a smart way to go about it. And something I should put more thought into there as well, because I would love to just, instead of sporadically giving or this or that, to see one thing that I'm motivated about and passionate about, and see that slowly make a difference over time would be very cool. So those were my key takeaways. I'm not sure if I missed anything in my blog writing I've got right up here next to the webcam, but again, if it's on YouTube that you're watching this, I'll include the full thing down below. But those were really the big takeaways. It's a really cool moment. And if you have any questions, it depends when you do the question, it might not be fresh in my brain anymore, but love to hear from you. But thanks and have a good one, everyone.